I'm going to talk to you tonight about faith, and I want you to understand how the concept of faith and the origins of faith begin. And, you know, and we look back in the life of Abraham in Genesis chapter 15, and we first understand faith because we see it in the context, and Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness, just because he believed God. And the Hebrew word that is used there is amen. The Hebrew word amen is where we derive the word amen. And really, it is just really, it's agreement with God. That's the whole origins of it, because we can know, we can jump from that, those passages there in Moshiata. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, now there's a moving of the Holy Ghost right now, and some of you are just so distracted and busy. Some of you so just caught away in your notes that you didn't even feel it. You didn't even feel the wave. You didn't feel the wave. And you don't feel the wave, I'm not going to help you. I'm going to start pointing these things out to you. I'm going to start pointing things out. There's movings of the Spirit of God in the house. I'm not here to do a little show for you, do a little dance, pull a rabbit out of a hat, a couple other tricks, entertain you. I'm here to teach you how to move with God. Hallelujah. How to move in the Holy Ghost. How to quit doing your stuff. Get into His stuff. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. And we know, ha ha, who, ha 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 ha. Hallelujah. We know that verse of Scripture gives to us a hallmark concept of faith, because we can jump to Romans chapter 4 and recognize that Abraham's the father of faith, as it were. You know, he's one who's a model of faith. Yes. And really, to say the father of faith is wrong. A father in faith, a model of faith is correct. God Almighty is the father of faith. Praise God. And he gives it to everybody. God has given a measure of faith to every man. And He gives us a context for that. And in that context, He's talking to us about being faithful with His faith. And really, when you look throughout the whole growth and maturation, or if you would, development of this concept in the Old Testament, the very next word that you come to is faithful and faithfulness. God is the God of faith. He's a faithful God. God is God. He is the faithful God. What is that? Deuteronomy chapter 7. You see faithfulness over and again as the description of who He is. And you hear about certain men who are faithful to God. You hear God's declaration about what He will do and how He will respond to those who will be faithful to Him. We understand that, once again, that word's amen. It's an agreement with God. It's literally a walk with God. It's a walk. God gives every man a measure of faith. It's a supernatural divine ability to do His exploits, to know what He knows, to live in heaven, to live in His realm, to agree with Him, to be a partner with what it is He's doing. But you look at the context of that and you'll understand, when God has given a measure of faith, He has given to us responsibilities that we must be consecrated to, that we must faithfully be committed to. And then that faith is developed, it grows, it increases. You got faith, you got to walk with God. You got faith, you got yourself a walk with God. You got faith, you got the ability to move mountains out the way. You got the ability to quench the violence of fire, to escape the edge of the sword, to stop the mouths of lions, to say to sycamine trees, be plucked up by the roots, to live in a realm where everything impossible is possible, where you believe what God says, where you hear what He demands. Have my faith. It doesn't matter whether you said that verse of Scripture says have faith in God, or have God's faith. It really is most appropriately and literally translated, have God's faith. You willing to fight for something? Huh? I tell you right now, you'll fight for that which you most dearly love. You'll fight for that which you're most passionate about. And we want you to come to so dearly love Christ Jesus and so dearly love the movings of the Spirit. The movings of God. The outworkings of His power and of His presence. The manifestation of the Holy Ghost. I am a zealot for the spiritual realm. I'm zealous for the things of the Spirit. I'm zealous and I'm a zealot and covetous for prophecy and for the prophesying realm. I know about how people can take any kind of an anointing and abuse it. You hear me now? You listen to me now, because your soul is at stake. Your soul is at stake. You listen, your soul is at stake. You pay attention. Your soul is at stake. Just because you've been born again, you can abuse that anointing. You can abuse it. Solomon was given the great power of God to be the wisest person. Great riches, great honor to be able to stand God's stead as king over His people. And he took the anointing that God had given him and he abused it to where he actually, with that, because of the abuses of that anointing, he destroyed the kingdom that God gave him, the greatest wisdom and insight to rule effectively. Think about it. I could go on and on like this all night. People don't understand that God has given to them, every man, a measure of faith, that they have a measure of faith, and there's nothing that could be so much more precious than this. You take stacks of gold, you pile it as high as the highest mountain, and say you're the owner of it. How so much you can't even contain it in any place. It's a mountain high. It's high as the highest mountain, like the Himalayas. Still, it would not compare, not a fraction, to the preciousness and the glory and the power and the riches of the measure of faith that you've been given. And people just throw it aside. They don't know how to move with it. They don't know how to develop it. They don't know how to grow in it. Because this faith is operated by the Holy Ghost. God gives His faith as a gift, but it only is operated by the Holy Ghost. It only develops because you agree with the Word of God, because you move with Him, because you begin to hate your life from this world, because you begin to be, you so despise the working of your own human ability that you're absolutely dedicated to denying yourself, because it won't work in that realm. It's time that there's somebody somewhere in this nation, a people, not just a few individuals, a people that will hear the Word of God and value what Father's made available. Amen. Will recognize and understand the movings of the Spirit of the Lord. It'll be more important to you than your food you're going to eat tomorrow and all the other stuff you're going to do with your life tomorrow and say it was a success in God. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. All these mind-blinding spirits, I bind them in Jesus' name. You foul spirit of hell. You lying, persecuting thing. You resisting power of hell. In Jesus' name. You have no rights. Oh, Father, let your people. Hey, quiet. Let your people rise up. In divine power and authority. Let your people rise up. Quit being pushed around. Amen. We're not here to placate you, accommodate you, babysit you. We're here to call you to a place of great glory and honor and demand of you a right response. To demand of you a right response. Hallelujah. God demands a right response. Hallelujah. He does. Somebody told me the other night, said, my goodness, when you start preaching, your face looks ferocious, your eyes change his colors. I said, well, I can't help it. I just smiled, really. I didn't say anything, because I can't. Huh? The good thing is they recognize it as the power of God and not human. Not something human, not something earthly. People are so bent on their self and their way that all they can see is a self-defense. They don't hear the Spirit of the Lord. Living in the self realm will always cause you to create a self-defense, and you will put up a barrier between you and the Word of God and will not hear it, and will become ultimately violent against those who speak it, because you become that much more offended. Ask the Pharisees. Ask even just the everyday people of Israel in Nazareth. They weren't even Pharisees. They were Nazarites. Nazarenes. People from Nazareth, rather. Not Nazarenes. People from Nazareth. They become so offended at the Word of God. They're praying. They're fasting. They're crying out, "Oh God, send your word. Revive us. Oh God, we love you so much. Send the Messiah, the Deliverer." Here he is. And they hate him, because they've never learned the movings of the Spirit. They've never learned the ways of God. They never learned to discern who he is and what he does and how he comes. Oh, manisikatala. Papa needs a people that will go ahead and move with him and hunger and thirst after righteousness and love the movings of the Spirit and value the things that he has made available to us. More important than anything else, where all the rest of it looks nothing more like nothing more than trash. I mean, you could have created a word that would inspire more disdain than what Paul used. Poop. There's several words for it. Master more appreciative of dung. That doesn't really relate, to the necessary impact. It doesn't really communicate, rather. Nate, come on. We want you to have that kind of an encounter, that kind of contrast, that kind of need, that kind of hunger. Hallelujah. 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 To be in meetings where your desire and your passion is just so captivated, because you want to be there where the richness of the Word of God is being communicated. You want to be there where the manifest presence of His glory is there. You want to be where, in that place where worship takes you to your knees, takes your heart to a place of raptured away. You want to be in that place where, you know, you're so caught away in God that the gifts of the Spirit just flow. There's no more self-consciousness. Amen. There's no more awkward. Hallelujah. There's no more fear or shame or sense of failure or you can't do it, because you're no longer looking at the arm of flesh that you come to so value. You're looking at gazing upon Him, and I'm telling you, an explosion comes out of you. Amen. I want you to grab, amen. What does that mean? You agree. That's the whole beginnings, if you would, of the simple understanding of where faith takes us, what belief takes you. If you're here this morning, we set you up for a whole new, as it were, definition of what it means to believe. As we laid it out there in the first epistle of John. But understanding that this whole moving of faith, this whole supernatural faith, is a supernatural expression of the power of God. It's the simplest forms of it. The simplest forms of it comes with such dimensions of power and creative authority that you can tell a mountain be moved and cast into the sea, to rearrange geography, to say to the moon and to the sun, "Stand still, obey my command." Universe, put on the brakes, so to speak. Faith defined by Jesus Christ is there a man, a centurion, who says, speak the word only, and I know my servant will be made whole. I don't need for you to come to my house. Speak the word only, the word. I agree with the word. I believe in the word. I understand the authority of the word. The word of God has the highest and most supreme authority. Surely it will do what it is you said it will do. Surely it will produce those things which he speaks and which he commands with it. Jesus says, this is faith. And Papa's given to every man a measure of it.
Amen.
Amen. People, I pray in the name of Jesus. From this night, you'll begin to pour out your life for the one who gave it all to you. Amen. You'll stand up against everything that would defy his word and defy that which he's commanded and defy that which he's ordained. You'll get passionate and zealous, be eaten up, consumed with the things of the Spirit. That's active. Oh, hallelujah. That's a fight. It's a good fight of faith. Huh? Hallelujah. Mombrosakiria. I don't want to be in the company of the weak and the profane. No way. I'll be in the company of the mighty. I'm being the company of those who are sold out to God, not playing games on God, not misrepresenting God. Oh, Monserias. Maladea Hesia. Ekibro Supra Daramama. Somebody say, you're special forces of the kingdom of God. No, normal forces. Normal. Average. Average. Hallelujah. Average, just ordinary. Huh? People are the Spirit of the Lord, who's been vested with power greater than archangels, power greater than the seraphim, than the mighty of the Lord and the host of his counsel. That has sat around and beheld his glory and heard his word, vested with more, vested with the authority of God himself, Christ Jesus. And we're worried about what? Some wilted flower? Some failing calf? What? Some bank account that doesn't look like it's enough to satisfy your lust? What? What has your heart captivated? Well, Father's given you the measure of faith. Oh, to know the movings of the Spirit of the Lord. Oh, to know the movings of God. Oh, to understand those things which his word would produce within us, called revelation. Oh, that's worth laying before his presence. Oh, that's worth hearkening unto his word, obeying his voice, seeking more, hungering for more, listening for more, searching for more, desperate for more, desiring more. Sitting at his feet as you ponder those things which he's spoken. God, show me, it's here, I know. Your word is spirit and life. Father demands it all. If a man come to me, I'm just going to read this real quickly. If a man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, in his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And all the people come along with all their little ideas and all their little explanations to explain away such consecration, such abandonment of life, and the own individual purpose to leave it sterile and lifeless, that it cannot reproduce the kind of consecration and commitment that God demands. And thus there's a powerless church with a bunch of powerless believers who yawn at the movings of God. And no discernment to recognize the presence of the Lord. Let it not be in your life.
Amen.
I'd rather be in isolation until the Spirit of the Lord speaks through me than to go around and be a blabbermouth. Huh? With only religion to display. No one needs to do that, for God has given to every man a measure of faith. And he demands us to be sober in that. I mean, I'm kind of like stuck right here in Romans chapter 12. I can't hardly get out of it. And Romans chapter 12, and I know I've got you in Luke chapter 12, and I want to keep you there, because I got some things that I want to say, but I'm just going to move with the Spirit of the Lord. And I want you to quickly, I know it's a journey. And I hope it's not too hard on your fingers. Make you too uncomfortable or be an inconvenience for you. But turn around and change your dream. I mean, I think that sometimes Father is having to talk to us like that. Oh, this isn't too much of a convenience for you, but I want to show you something that expanded the universe in the day that I spoke. Hallelujah. I want to show you how to speak according to those things which I understand and which I know. I want to display my mighty power through your life. I want to show you how to face death and command it to live again. I want to show you how to look into the eyes of the blind and all that you see is white and command pupils to appear. I want to show you how to stand against every force of hell that would cause you to be intimidated and fear and run and retreat and stand there boldly and shout out those things which I have spoken. It's true. I'd like to see some of you get as excited as I am tonight. I'd like to see some of you get as loud as I am. I got a river. If you want to understand wherever this comes from, I got a river. I got the river. Oh, I don't just sing about it, talk about it. I have it. It's activated in my life. Hallelujah. Do I look like I'm bored? Do I look like I'm about half asleep? Do I look like I need rest? Mosate. Do I look like I'd rather be in some other place? Well, come follow me then. Because not every one of you look like that. Come follow me. Come sit on the edge of your seat with hunger. Come sit on the edge of your seat with thirsting. Come sit on your edge of the seat with saying, oh God, I must have more. Oh Lord Jesus, these things of heaven. You begin to sing believing for the impossible. You can't just sit around and sing believing for the impossible. There's got to be a passion in your heart because you're right in the big middle of it. Because without a miracle, you're dying. Yeah. Most people don't need a miracle. They're just fine. They don't need God. They're just fine. They got it all worked out. Got it all worked out. The budget's all worked out. Provision's all planned out. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger barns to take care of my substance. You fool. This day shall your soul be required of you. Too many people live as a fool. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God, but the fool is also the person who lives like there's no God. Who says they believe, but they still live like they're not going to give an account to him. That they can just do whatever they want, and God's going to say, well done. You're not going to ignore God's word. You're not going to ignore God's Holy Spirit and hear God say anything like that. Father produces those in those who walk with him a hunger and a passion and a desperation that's crying out like a child in need of the dad. Dad, where are you? This is the Spirit of the Son. Dad, where are you? Dad! I just some little Abba Father. It's Dad. You're my dad. I'm your son. I'm in a relationship with you. I'm here to be obedient to you. What is it that you demand of me? What is it that you desire of me? I'm going to do it. There's people around us that are dying by the millions every day. And the only thing that's going to make a difference is when you and I step into the supernatural display of the power of God. Otherwise, they're going to remain prisoners to the mind-blinding spirits and the deceptions of hell that have them in prison. Their only possibility of their escape is somebody to move in the power of heaven, to move in the power of faith. Someone to be faithful with that which God has given. It's true. And when that becomes your heart, you don't sit around looking bored no more. And I sit around just doing it your own way, walking all over the anointing, wondering why God doesn't move in your life. You withhold from God, I'm telling you right now, He will withhold from you. If you're not willing to be intimate with Him, He will not be willing to be intimate with you. Believe it. You don't draw nigh to him, he's not drawing nigh to you. This is a reality. Somehow people just feel like that God's just their servant, their slave, just do whatever they want to do. He's just there, he's convenient, he's a little doll, he's a little God doll on the shelf. In Jesus' name, let the zeal of the Lord stir you up with such a ferocious passion against such defiance of the Spirit of the Lord. Things that Satan would try to develop within the thinking of men, within the actions of men, within the culture of men, within making those things acceptable to men who supposedly had clean escaped his realm of influence. Now, you know, you can't get into 12 and start talking about this measure of faith without understanding. I beg you, I plead with you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. People, it's our body is the temple of God. We want God to operate over here. Hello. Your body is his temple. Understand the consecration of your life because of the demand, the consecration of your life, because you're being your sacred. You're sacred. You're sacred. You're not trying to be acceptable. You've been made holy and acceptable. My goodness, how can you take that for granted? Yeah. How can you take that for granted? Only because you do not believe. It's true. You start believing that, and suddenly you're going to get more. You're going to get as ferocious about it as I am. You're going to get as violent about it as I am. You're going to get intense about it as I am. To watch all these things going down, which profane his name. Where people seek their own stuff. They seek their own kingdom. They seek their own pleasure. They seek their own will. It's not about obeying God and following God. It'd be a terrible thing to get there and he said, I did not know who you are. I don't even know what you're talking about. Who are you? I guarantee you start living by the word, speaking his word, doing what he commands. You're not going to be running any risk of him saying, I don't know who you are. I don't know what you're talking about. Why, what, you know, where do you even come from? You listen to me. Because he's talking about fellowship. He's talking about fellowship. And there's so many people that are willing to just overlook these things and somehow believe that they can be in a realm of just a religious posture before God where most of their life is about them and they haven't even come close to doing what Jesus said. And I just read in Luke chapter 15, they've never gotten that close to him. They know nothing about a walk with God. They know nothing about intimacy with God and fellowship with God, and they somehow think that they're exempt. You're not. You're not. It's about time we go for the proofs, people. The proofs which God has given, the proofs which John laid out there. You know, I'm getting ready to send this first epistle, first, second, third epistle of John around to a couple of people just so that the grammar, you know, and the way we said things just isn't repulsive. It's really a big deal. Who cares if I said is instead of are? The point's going to be there. The need to grab a hold of what God says. The need to find our value in what God has given rather than our value in what? I mean, goodness gracious. I would be more excited about hanging around somebody who knows how to flow in the Holy Ghost but doesn't even know their ABCs. Huh? Wouldn't know what 2 + 2 is from anything. And then you're speaking another language. But they know how to do signs and wonders and miracles. They know how to move in heaven. But we don't value that in our culture. And many people have been so influenced by that. They're all high on what man can do out of the realms of intellect. And the spirit is just little teeny tiny. Hardly in existence. And faith, well, that just sat there and it's been wrapped up in a cloth and it's been hidden in the earth. Faith is something that is supposed to be actively engaged in and is all about us walking in a relationship with him and moving in the realms of all that he's supplied on the definition of how he supplied it. And there's not a reason that anybody should lack any understanding here, because God devoted a chapter in the Bible, Hebrews chapter 11, to talk to us about what faith does, what it looks like in people, what it does through people, and how now it's now extended to us to do the same thing. And without it, you can't please God. And that goes far beyond whatever little confession you might have that has no divine power expression to it. I'm going to tell you right now, if you could live your life to do nothing more than when you open your mouth and you begin to praise and worship, heaven comes and fills your soul. When heaven comes and fills your soul when you praise and worship, you know what happens? Heaven fills the atmosphere around you. If you could do nothing but have faith take you and develop in your life where you are excited, more excited about God than pedaling out in the surf or doing whatever it is that you do that you think is so spectacular, we want a badge of honor. We want a medal of honor for failing. And if we do anything that is the smallest increment above failure, then we want a whole choir of praise and certificates and honors to be broadcasted and trumpets sounded. You might as well laugh, because that's you. I'm talking about you. I'm talking about the human race. I'm talking about man. Who's not known how or learned how to flow in the Holy Ghost, who's not learned how to lose their life, and the whole reason they've not learned how to flow in the Holy Ghost is because of that condition. You got to rise up and say, no more, I'm not having it. I beg you, Paul said, that you present yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and that's where you get started here. That's where you get started here. Hallelujah. That means everything I have and all my resources, I bring it to bear for the kingdom of God, for the purposes of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God sees people, see God's anointed people and say, listen, you know, I don't have the anointing you have right now, but I'm going to be every bit of the finances that I have is at your disposal. Somebody heard I was sending for a tent. They called me up, said, don't send for it. I'll pay for the transport to bring it. I want all that I have to be at the disposal of the King. I don't have the anointing to move like that, like you're moving right now, but let me finance it. Come on, people. Put your stuff at the disposal of the King. Bring your resources to bear. Quit pretending what it means to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Acting like a little hallelujah, a little blow into the handkerchief. Huh? Or the Kleenex. Give me a break. Bring your life to bear. Come follow Jesus. Take up your cross. Deny yourself. Come be willing to lay your life down for a lost and dying world. To be a part of everything that God is doing, to sow into everything that God is doing, to say all I exist for are the divine purposes of God. That's what Paul's saying, because that's what he's modeling. He's saying, listen, guys, I found the spot. I found the spout where the glory comes out. Come stand over here. That's all he's saying. Listen, I found the realm of connecting with heaven. I found the place of walking this thing out that Jesus Christ has called us to. Come on over here. This is what you got to do. Hallelujah. And I'm so glad you're clapping right now. I praise God. I'm out there right now. That day, somebody said, I preached like this. People just in shock. They got to carry him out in shock. They start, it's a slow bleed out the back door. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. When God sends me someplace, he didn't send me to get invited back anyways. Hallelujah. He sent me to declare his word, to speak, to describe what he says. I'm telling you right now, come on. Come on. Man, I look at these men's lives. I look at these champions in the faith and what God did through them, and recognize that that's what everybody ought to be doing. It's not some kind of specialized grace that was put upon one man. It's what's supposed to be upon the entire divine race. Everyone who's been born of the Spirit. Then we recognize then there's some changes got to be made. Amen. And if you can't hear when it's softly spoken, yes, say it louder. Amazing how people who are hard of hearing can hear it when you say it louder. Amen. Praise God. He's going to sit up and be not conformed to the world, but be transfigured by thinking different, by the renewing of your mind. Why? Listen, God wants you to be in a place where you can prove what's right and what's wrong. He wants you to be in a place where you can come to be taught to understand His good and perfect and acceptable, what is good and perfect and acceptable to the Lord. What's right, what's wrong, what He wants of our life, how to move with Him, and how to shut down those things that would prevent us from being the people that He's called us to be. He says it here, don't be conformed to the world, but be transfigured by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect. The good and acceptable and perfect will of God. If you are highlighting anything, you highlight will of God. And you start at Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, and you better find yourself in under the spotlight of heaven saying, Father, am I doing your will? Or am I a problematic person in the kingdom of God? You're not. Don't get nervous. Am I just a troublemaker? Am I just a dead weight? Am I doing the will of the Father? Oh, manderestia. Now, I'm telling you right now, for me, that whole concept of doing the will of God so strongly comes to bear right here. It lays it out right there. You just got it laid out for you in a very powerful way. We did. To understand how to move with the Holy Ghost, to go into all the world and preach the gospel. And there's no excuses for us not to go. To understand how to lay our life down so that we preach Jesus, minister Jesus, know that He's with us, and have that flow of the Holy Ghost that is absolutely essential for Him to be revealed, so that we begin to bring in a harvest everywhere we go, where people's lives are transformed and touched by His Spirit. Hallelujah, because we're doing what He told us to do. In Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and in the uttermost parts of the world. Today, you know, I saw Hillary, they had a little flash on the Twitter where she was passed out. Then I heard all these comments going on. I saw her staggering, and I was moved with great Holy Ghost compassion for the woman. And I thought, how can all of these sharks be swimming around, poking fun at her and doing all this mocking? And many of those sharks are Christians, so-called. It's amazing when people get wrapped up in their mind games and become twisted around the ideologies of men. Now they become so perverted, they have the image of the devil rather than the image of Christ Jesus. And I just felt so strong. I'm going to tweet right now, praying for Hillary, for her body to be healed, and that she have an encounter with Him. Got it on Facebook. I'm just everywhere I could possibly come out and just have somebody standing there saying, no, I'm not for this lying stuff. Give me a break. I'm talking about a soul. I'm talking about a human being who's going to spend eternity somewhere whom Christ Jesus died for. The movings of God in our life is an expression of the faith that He's given to us, where we are, where we're moving with Him, with what He wants. We're agreeing with Him and what He wants from every dimension of life and every expression of that which belongs to Him and belongs to heaven and belongs to His ways. It's got no hell in it. It's got no demon in it. It's got no devil in it. It's got no hate in it. It's not got no preference in it. It's amazing to me. And we follow the wrong thing. Let's get a rebel. Come on, let's have a revival. Let's get a move of God going. It ain't going to even happen till you start moving with God. There's not going to be no move of God till you know how to move in the Holy Ghost. You're either going to be those coals of fire that God uses to create the raging fire storm of heaven called revival, or you're just going to be a person sitting around, you know, just giving your 2 cents. It's amazing how everybody wants to come and give their 2 cents, and they've never done anything. And if we followed their 2 cents or their ideas about things, we'd be as stuck as they are. It's amazing how sharp people are when they want to comment on what you're doing. We need your ideas. What's your ideas been doing for you? If I follow your ideas, I might be as stuck as you are. Give me a break. I don't want your ideas. Amen. I want to see somebody moving with Jesus. I follow. Amen. Yes. I move too. Amen. No, ideas. Your ideas? I'm interested in the ideas of somebody who's shaking nations. I'm interested in their ideas. Hey, make these adjustments, do this. Yeah. And there I still make sure it lines up with the Word of God. Amen. And what God's called me to do. Amen. Because I've had people do more in the faith than I have. And they said, listen, you know, make these changes, do these changes, just do these things. And I'm like, Lord, is that what you want me to do? I don't want to be contrary or in any way, you know, stubborn against your Word. And then just seek God. And he said, no, you do what I've called you to do. I've called you to do this. Amen. And take me to his word and show me in his word where he's called me to do it. Just do it. You stay right with the program. But I'm not interested in the ideas of some comments of somebody and done nothing. What have you done? Get provoked right now. Start doing something. Amen. Get them to do something. Amen. Do something with your faith. Amen. And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to say it once again. I don't believe you could do anything more glorious with faith than to develop such an intimacy with him that when you go to worship, you just caught away. You become just a basket case in the kingdom of God. You just like, you just every part, you can see your hairs dancing. Every part of your body is broken before giving you a broken, empty vessel. Your teeth are worshiping. I mean, everything. There's nothing you can do great with faith. I watch people, they don't allow faith to be developed on the basic level of intimacy with God. They have the same expressions that they've had years gone by. Faith has not profited you. The word has not profited you. It has not been developed. It's not grown. It's not matured. It's been wrapped in a napkin and set in the earth because you had other fish to fry. You had other issues more important to you. You had other things that you believed in more. Huh? I'd hate to stand before the presence of the Lord and the Lord say to me, I gave you the ability to worship. Well, let me say this, you can get everybody that ability. I gave you the ability to play music and develop music in a cunning way. And you did nothing with it. I don't want to be able to say that he gave me anything I didn't do anything with. I want to be faithful. I want to be found faithful with everything he's spoken. These works and greater works. To be found faithful with that means I'm going to press in. It doesn't matter what disappointments. It doesn't matter what discouragements. It doesn't matter what's getting in my way. To be faithful when he said to go to the nations, it doesn't matter what kind of obstacles. It doesn't matter how slow it's going or how I didn't get where I wanted to go as quickly as I wanted to get there. I'm going to be pushing it. I'm going to be pressing in. I'm going to be faithful with those things which he said. It's agreeing with God. That's faith. That's believing. That's where it all happens. This is where the excitement is. This is where mountains get moved around. This is where everything that is impossible becomes possible. This is where we begin to understand what it means to have a relationship with him on such a level that whatever we ask, he'll do it. Because where our heart does not condemn us, our heart does not convict us, our heart does not strike us or hold us down. Man, if I was sitting listening to somebody preach like this, I would have already done at least 3 laps around the place. I'd have probably jumped over 4 rows. I'd have been up shouting. I'd been going, whoa, come on, come on. Somebody's got it. Somebody's bringing it. Now, to do that, you're going to have to get doing it. To say that, you're going to have to, because there's no way you can be doing all excited about it when you're sitting around doing nothing. Huh? Because all you are is your spotlight's on you. Oops. Sitting. Doing nothing. I don't believe that there's any, I'm going to say it again. I don't believe there's anything greater that we can be doing and developing in the realms of supernatural expressions, because faith is supernatural expressions of God. It's the divine expressions of Almighty God. That's what faith is. It's His Word coming to life and being made manifest in us. It's His Word, the power of His Word through our mouth now being spoken, where whatever we say, it happens. You okay? Good. Just checking. Make sure you're still holding it together. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm doing that with every one of you, actually. I just do it a little bit more covertly, discreetly. Huh? Speak in general. I can tell when you're resisting what I'm saying, because that God's given me the ability. I can tell when you're sponging what I'm saying. I can tell when you just get all caught up in your own condemnation and sense of looking to your own arm of flesh to make it happen instead of running to the prayer room. I can see when somebody's got a heart like, I'm all I hold on God, or when somebody's got stammied going, how am I going to make this happen? How am I going to make this happen? Start working out the details and the steps. Stuck. Arm of flesh could do nothing. Nothing. Dead in the water. No rudder. No engine. No sail. Piece of chunk of metal floating around on an ocean. Jesus. When it begins to strike the heart of man in the realms of faith, that says, I'm going to lay hold on the things of the Spirit. I'm going to begin to move here. I'm going to understand how to start imitating. It's never too late for any of us. You could be 89 years old tonight and it would be too late for you. It's not too late till you're not living anymore. It's not too late. Let me just say this. I will say this. The older you get, here's the risk. The older you get, the more you become set in your ways. You run a risk. And if the older you are here tonight, the more you need to self-evaluate. The more you need to contrast and compare yourself to what God said in His Word. The more you need to bend your will. The more you need to bow your knee. The more you need to give force to your body and your being to conform to the Word. True? Because the older you are, you're no exception. I'm no exception. No one is exception. The older you are, the more set you are in what you've done up to this point. Your way. The older you become, the less you are willing to follow and be led. True. Why? Because to follow and be led by the Holy Ghost is risky business. You got to be willing with abandonment to go when you don't even know where you're going, to dream bigger than you could ever possibly even have the right to. Who gave you the right to dream that big? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Becomes a damper. It becomes a wet blanket on the fire of God, a damper upon the light of His presence. Oh, yes, listen to me now. Because I'm talking to you. I'm not talking to anybody on the web. I don't even care about the web tonight. I'm talking to you. And you better get earnest with God, and you better get passionate with God, because otherwise you're going to be a victim of everything that all the rest of the human beings that have lived with you and before you were victimized by and fell prey to. I'm talking about faith. Understand faith here. See, Paul's developing complete and total abandonment to God. See, a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. Complete abandonment to God, to learn how to think like God, don't think like you anymore, to be completely transfigured by thinking different, by the renewing of your mind, making sure that there's nothing about your culture, and let me say culture rather than the world. There's nothing about your human culture, your United States of America culture, your religious denominational culture. By the way, I'm not into denominations. Hallelujah. 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 We've been nominated to be the sons of God. We're sticking with that. We've been nominated. Hallelujah. Ha, ha, ha. We've been nominated by the Lord Jesus Christ as candidates for the baptism of the Holy Ghost in fire. Ha, ha. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Total abandonment. Total consecration to understanding that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. That's not three wills. What a wiggle worm. Huh? What a way to try to get out of the life of consecration that Paul is now calling you and I to come into. Listen, he's not talking to somebody else. He's talking to you. God's not talking to somebody else. He's talking to you. Amen. And he demands change.
Yeah.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And he supplied the power and the ability of change.
Amen.
And he supplied, hallelujah, hurapakanaya, hallelujah, the strength and the energy. The divine equipment, divine resources. Somebody said, who finances you? And you know, a little bit, you know, intrusive, you know, a little rude. But I said, God. I mean, they were being intrusive and rude. I wasn't when I said God. Because it is true. God. No, really. Come on. Because this is the realms of faith. Man is so stuck on human provision, the provision of man. Hallelujah. Hamasete rina mosaya. Kedi anomonda. I'm glad I'm not there. I'm glad I'm learning how to move in faith and let faith be developed, which is simply agreeing with God. Now, I'm telling you right now, he's going to shock you because he's going to tell you to walk on the water. See, might as well agree with him. Huh? And don't even go get you some special walk on the water shoes. Try to figure out some unique way to make this happen. Just say, yes, Lord, yes. I'm going after this thing in the spirit. I'm going to learn how to recognize the movings of God and move with him. That's all it takes. What is it called? Yieldedness. How does that happen? Worship. Worship. It's the place, it's the basic beginnings, it's the origin of where we come to him and interact with him in worship. A sacrifice that is offered, an offering that is given, something that costs me something. We receive the abundance from God and act like it's some big price to pay when we go to give in the offering. I was thinking, you know, now Ruthiana's getting ready to have a baby. She's no exception. But it's just what's happening right now. Thinking, Lord, what offering could I offer in praise and thanksgiving to you for the Ruthiana's baby that's about to be delivered? I don't know that people even think that way anymore. I learned it from reading the word and recognizing that everybody who had a walk with God thought that way. I'm not interested in thinking the way that the culture that I was raised in thinks. I'm interested in understanding the culture of the kingdom of God that is expressed in the word. Understanding how to think the way he thinks. Understanding how to move the way he moves. It was, you don't need to bring them. Not the law. And then they're going to give their all-knowing knowledge and they not move forward with God. And I'm not listening. I'm going to hear what Job had to say on it. I'm going to hear what Abraham had to say on it. I'm going to hear what Moses had to say on it. I'm going to hear what Jesus had to say on it. I'm going to hear what Paul had to say on it. Come on now. What offering can I bring to you, Father, for all that you've done for me this day? What offering can I bring? For the sacrifices that you've made for me, for your long suffering towards me, your mercy, your goodness extended to me even when I didn't get it.
Amen.
Your willingness to move through me even when I was so full of myself, I don't even see how you did it.
Amen. Thank you.
He's amazing.
Yeah.
What offering can I bring? What offering can I bring? How can I show you my thanks, my gratitude? How can I show you the love and the affection that I feel in my heart because of what you've done? Have you talked to him? Have you heard his answer? Talk to him. He's got an answer. Talk to him. Oh, I'm not telling you the secrets he whispered to me. Some I will tell you, some I will not. You have to find out your own intimacy with him. You'll have to start making him more important to you than you. You'll have to start recognizing that he did it instead of you did it. That the Spirit of the Lord in his mercy and grace did these things for you, not the arm of flesh and your own human effort and ability. You have to get yourself some intimacy. You have to get yourself some gratefulness, some thanksgiving, some reality is going to have to set in your heart. Because you spend a little bit more time with him than you do with the other things in this life. It will perish with the using. Come on now. Or we're just trying to get you set up for faith. I'll get to my opening passage here in a minute. Seems like the Lord does it a little different with me. God gives some people opening passage, and that's what they open with. God gives me a closing passage. I'm going to let him just do whatever he wants. I'm not going to constrain him. I'm going to enjoy this. Do I look uptight?
No.
Do I look worried or concerned?
No.
Do I look like I'm, you know, going to, you know, get a popularity review tonight? I'm not. I'm just happy in God. I'm filled with the zeal of the Lord. I'm burning with the fire of God in my belly. Hallelujah. I'm not trying to come up with something to say. I got a river. What a great grace. I've got overcoming power tomorrow that I can stand against every force of hell who would try to shut down the life of God in me. The life of Christ Jesus. I don't need a microphone to speak like that, actually. I get a river. Ha, sateya de bikilaya. Ha, sutambrata haya. Ha, what can I offer to the King? What offering can I bring in thanksgiving that is worthy of that which you've done for me? How can I reciprocate your great grace, your great abundance and generosity towards me? These are the kinds of things that he says. Present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. He calls us over to this place to be taught of him, to learn from him, to receive that which he's freely given. It is the best offering. One of the best offerings that we can give to him is to love and cherish and value that which he gave everything for us to be able to have. I'm not interested in religion. I'm not interested in philosophies and ideologies and concepts of men. I'm interested in him. I'm not interested in songs to be sung. I'm interested in touching his heart and telling him that I love him. Touching his heart and ministering to him and letting him see something real coming out of a human being redeemed by the blood. Given his divine spirit. Hallelujah.
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 Mahanasita. Mahananasita. 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 There's riches to me. Those are riches to me. There's sparokiriatla. It's riches because it's the signs of the believer. One of the signs of the believer. Authority over unclean spirits is one of the signs of the believer. Ability to have authority over scorpions and serpents and have ability over the poisons of men. One of the signs of the believer. The ability to lay hands on the sick. They must recover. Sign of the believer. Nothing so important to me. Nothing so important to me. Borasatarara mekishti. Sutandala la vashikaraha. Meneshti prenenengala. Hallelujah. Menazulos Jesus. Hallelujah. Krosuvridingdila. For I say through the grace of God given unto me, to every man that is among you, do not think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. But think soberly, as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. God has given me a measure of faith, and He wants to develop it, and He wants it to grow, and He wants it to mature. And He says, okay, I want you to be faithful with what I've given you. He says, by that measure of faith, He's given, you know, he begins to describe once again the context of the body of Christ. As I've said before, the body of Christ is really only defined within the context of the moving of the Holy Spirit, the giftings of God being manifested through our life. Otherwise, there's no expression, there's no true expression of the body of Christ or the members of Christ. It's, as it is expressed that way in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it's expressed in the same way over here in Romans chapter 12 as I'm getting ready to read this to you. So many people want to talk about how they're the body of Christ and how they're moving as the body of Christ, and there's no real expression of the manifest presence and glory of the Holy Ghost being revealed through their lives. And that's got to change, and that is only going to change because people become hungry and passionate and thirsty and desperate, and they're not willing to live as they've lived any longer. That's what it takes. God gives us free, but it's so sacred, still so sacred. And unless you're desperate for it, you'll abuse it. You'll abuse it. And even people who've been desperate for it became high on themselves and abused it. It's true. Many people have fallen flat on their face with the great graces of God that were entrusted unto them. You know, the scripture just rings out in my spirit right now. I just want you to turn to it real quick. Hold your finger on Romans chapter 12, because I'm not finished there yet. I just feel the Spirit of the Lord has more things to say there. And I pray tonight that the Word of God is not given to you in vain. I pray tonight that you demand a change. God has already demanded it. He's not going to force your will. You got to bend your will. And the bending of your will is to demand of yourself what God has commanded, to demand it. I was saying in a meeting not too long ago, I don't remember where I was at, but I was saying you need to demand. You may need to place a demand upon these things. And I recognize the Spirit of the Lord said, they don't even know what you're talking about. They think that you're just talking about demanding me. I immediately said, and I'm not talking about you demanding God. I'm talking about you demanding yourself. You got to place a demand on yourself. You got to grab a hold of yourself by the nape of the neck and say, you get over here and you get down on your knees and you touch heaven now. Instead of doing whatever it is that you normally do, go over there and pacify yourself. Go get yourself a nose massage or whatever it is you do. Earlobe massage or whatever it is. I don't know. I think it's all as silly as ridiculous. Massage my toes. Massage my eyebrows. Jesus. Bless your heart. I look at the majesty and splendor. I look at the opulence of His creation, of His glory, the majesty of that which His hands have made, the purity, the magnificence of it. And I say, oh God, I gotta touch that realm. There's nothing more glorious, more wealthy, more powerful, more honorable than that which makes the sun to shine in its glory, the moon to reflect that light, the stars in their order and in their courses. Ah, that magnificence of all creation about us, the splendor of the rushing rivers and the waterfalls by the thousands. And on it goes of the works of His hands, of the display of the majesty of the word of His power. The word of His power. Oh, what a mighty word that comes forth from His mouth. What a display of great power. For with His word He commandeth the unclean spirits and they obey. They were astonished, ripped with amazement, fixated on the power and the glory of God that had visited them, and God has purpose to reduce it in every one of us, reproduce it in every one of us. And if we're going to be faithful with God, we're going to be faithful with these things. We're going to understand how to give ourselves to them, to be taught of God, to move with the Spirit of the Lord. And it's going to begin in an intimacy of worship. An intimacy of worship. An intimacy of praise. Oh, let me say to you. Somebody said, well, I don't know the song. Well, you just get caught away in the language of the Spirit then. You just get caught away in the strains, hallelujah, of desperation and love for Him. Ah, that I do. But just sitting there all passive and seemingly uninterested and distracted, like you've got other things on your mind. Person gets up to the mound and gets ready to hit the ball. You can just see them looking around. See who all's watching them. Think about what they're going to do afterwards. Look at the bug go by. Ain't not hitting nothing. Huh? They're out. They're done. Finished. Huh? Come on, people. Is a baseball worthy of more honor than the living God? Is an activity of an achievement or an accomplishment or a human goal more worthy than those things which God has proposed and offered us the opportunity to do with Him? Oh, let there come faith burning on the inside of you with passion and zeal tonight. It causes you to move out of your place of ease and comfort. It uproots you from your unwillingness to change, the fossilization of a human disposition. The Lord says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 11, Paul says, wherefore also we pray always for you, and I need to pray more for you. Paul, as leader and a minister, probably made this one of the major focuses of what it meant to be a minister and a leader. To pray that God's people would begin to step into what God had designed and purposed for their life. He said, I pray always for you that our God would count you worthy of this calling. What calling? These works and greater works. What calling? This oneness with Christ Jesus, this ministry of Christ Jesus, this fellowship of relationship with Him, this baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire, these signs of the believer, this unlimited power of God, this dunamis of heaven, this explosive work of grace that's supposed to be displayed through our lives. I want to learn. I want to understand. I want to be involved with the church. I will not be involved with the church. It's going to be anything less than passionate about God. I will not. I won't tolerate it. We'll rearrange the chairs. We'll hang them from the ceiling if we must. Whatever it takes to get the things adjusted properly. Hallelujah. Barring nothing. Oh, God. And it really, all it is, of course, you know, that was just a funny, extreme statement, meant nothing other than the fact that there's nothing we're willing not to do. And the most important thing Father wants us to do is to love Him with all of our heart and all of our soul, to get emotional about Him, to get excited about Him, to give Him our everything. To make Him the first thing, the most important thing, to be wholly devoted to Him and to His ways. Not because He needs something from us, but because that's the only way we're going to step into truth and life and be able to stand against everything the deception and iniquity would try to captivate us with. Because there's no room for compromise. Any compromise will ultimately result in total defeat. And I should have said that one real loud. That God would count you worthy of the call and to fulfill all the good pleasure of His goodness. Does that sound good right there by itself? Yes. I'm telling you, I'm experiencing that goodness. Amen. I'm experiencing that pleasure so much that I don't want anything possibly that would interfere with that. It is a great grief. It's such a grief to me. I want it no more. Give place no more. I get lovesick, homesick, desperate sick, relationship sick, beyond what I could even describe if anything interrupts that. to fulfill the good pleasure. To fulfill all the good pleasure of His goodness. You know, if I was writing that, I would have said to fulfill all the good pleasure of His will. And Paul did said it that way in Ephesians chapter 1. But here he says all the good pleasure of His goodness. He says, and here's how you're going to do it. With the work of faith with power. The work of faith with power. There's an action going on. There's an interaction going on. There's a cause and an effect going on right now. Where Father wants to bring us into a place of yieldedness to Him and cooperation with Him, that He may do this in us, that He may bring us to a place of such submission, that He may do this in us, to feel all the good pleasure of His goodness. Does that sound like a good time?
Yes.
I tell you, I promise you, there could not be a better time. I promise you, there could not be greater pleasure. I promise you, there could not be greater good things. I promise you, there could not be something more enjoyable than to have this. And it is something that you and I do, and is fundamentally found in us agreeing with Him. It's found in the amen. It's found in an amen, an amen that results in faith, believing that you believe me, you will agree with me. And it wasn't just some kind of convenient belief. It wasn't some kind of a convenient agreement. Well, that seems to work for me right now. Nothing lost, nothing gained. If it doesn't work out, we're even. Are you listening to me, what I'm saying to you? Because a lot of people think that way, don't even know they're thinking that way. You understand?
Yes.
No, if it doesn't work, we're dead, kind of thing. That's what Papa's looking at. That's what Abraham did. If it doesn't work, we're dead. Because we're going to go out here and expose ourselves. I mean, I was praising the Lord. We got home the other night, and I said, thank you, Lord, for the freedoms we enjoy in the United States of America, because we didn't meet any highway bandits. We weren't robbed on the way. We weren't threatened with guns and to have everything taken from us. All the stuff that happens in many third world countries. Thank you, Father, for the law and the order that we have here. Thank you for your peace and your provision that we have here. Abraham didn't have that. Hello. He didn't have that. You go into somebody else's territory, you did. Why? Because they want what you got. And the quickest way for them to get what you have is to kill you. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
For him to get where he went with God, it cost him a risk. He had to risk everything. Jesus. Train up a child in the way it should go. And that ain't it. Jesus. Oh, don't we just love to sit around and have a Bible study about what Abraham did? No, we just love to become experts on what Abraham did, so we can tell you every, show you on a map every footstep he took. How he got there and how long it took him to get there and what happened after he got there. And what God said and what he said and then what God said and what he did and then what God did. What Sarah said and what Hagar said and what Ishmael did. Come on, baby, that's not what that's about. That's not what this is about.
No.
Now, this spirit and life stuff, so that we'll do the same stuff.
Yes.
So we'll actually we'll have it reproduced in our life.
Amen.
Now, you said, I agree. You vowed a vow to God. You vowed a vow to God. As soon as you said amen, you vowed a vow to God.
Amen.
That's why I understand. Now I'm getting more understanding all the time why people remain silent in church. terrible thing to vow to God and not do it. Some of you don't want to do anything. It's going to remain silent. Not me. I'm going to scream out all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to cry out all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to bow all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to consecrate all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to plead all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to beg all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to demand all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to desire all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to press in all the more.
Amen.
I'm going to take everything God has for me.
Amen.
His work of faith with power. Wow. That's what Jesus did. That's the great exploits of faith. That's the great signs and wonders and demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Huh? That's saying to the that's holding a child up in front of everybody. That's being able to say, as William Branham did one day, where there was a young girl who had no pupils. Her eyes were completely white. He prayed for about six times. Nothing happened. He then turned to Jesus and said, Lord, you promised me in this relationship that I have with you that all I had to do was to pray and believe and you would do it. And he turned the child around so the child could face the audience. Immediately, her eyes formed pupils. She saw as well as anyone else. I mean, and on, we could talk about the exploits of men. Some died well, others did not die well. Some people got offended. Some people got involved in lust. Some people got sidetracked by this thing and that thing. Oh, but let there come forth a people of God who desperately seek Him, who lay hold on Him, who believe Him, who agree with Him, who are willing to fight the good fight of faith. Because I'm going to tell you right now, there's going to be all kinds of obstacles that are going to stand in your way. There's going to be all kinds of armies that are going to be, as it were, fortified against you ever being able to do this. And you're going to have to understand that there's a real narrow little path between it all, and you got to squeeze through it. It's a narrow way. Few there be to find it. I want you to turn quickly with me back to Luke, please, chapter 12. There's many, many more things to say about what we are ministering in Romans chapter 12. But you just understand, Paul brings it down. He says, get sober about where you're at. And with the faith that you've been given, consecrate yourself to it. Wait upon it. In other words, give yourself over to seeing that develop. Be faithful with it, because if you're faithful with it, it's going to result in a development and a growth and a maturation.
Amen.
You know, if we can take little guys and we can get them to faith, be faithful with worship and giving themselves to understanding how to flow in the anointing, it won't take long. They'll grow into a place where when they begin to pray, when they begin to praise the Lord, begin to play their instrument, heaven will come down. But if you can't get people to connect, it's just, oh my goodness gracious, what on earth is this sound? You hear me?
Yes.
You can't do it your own way.
Yes.
God's come, the Holy Ghost has come to teach us. He's come to give us skills. He was so heady, so confident about what they believe and what they think and what they know. Be careful, because you get in their meeting, you're going, my goodness, when is this over? When do we get to move on? I'd like to go touch heaven. You know what I'm saying? Let's just shut this thing down and everybody just start worshiping God. Because we're going nowhere with whatever's happening here. And be careful, because that could be your meeting. Unless you learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost and move with God, that will be your meeting.
Yeah.
Unless you learn how to hook up with the congregation of heaven, that will be your meeting. And the only people that will attend and enjoy it are the religious. And people don't know any different. And I'm just dedicated to making sure that nobody in here does such a meeting as that. I don't want to be in any meeting with you, any of you, that I'm like earnest to walk out of. Saying, what on earth? Please. This is what you think the move of God is? Wouldn't you hate for me to come in your meeting and that happen?
Yes.
Good. Are you with me in Luke chapter 12?
Yes.
I'll just start right up here and get in your stuff. I think I'm going to start right up here and get in your stuff. I'm going to start up here in verse 33 just so I can get in the middle of your stuff. Is that okay with everybody?
Yes.
Just checking. Sell that which you have. And give to the poor. Provide yourself bags which wax not old. And treasure in the heavens that fail not. Bring all your resources to bear to the kingdom of God. That's what the Lord is saying. He's saying it. You know, the Lord is just opening up here. From chapter 12 to chapter 15, he's just opening up. He's saying, this is how you get in. This is how you begin to walk with me. This is how it begins to move. I mean, it's like he opens up, you know, in John 13, 14, 15, 16, when he takes a towel and a basin and says, this is how it works. This is how the anointing works. You start washing feet. You start serving the ministry. You start serving one another. I praise God for everybody who's made their car a taxi cab to heaven today. There's over 12 new kids in the children's ministry. I was so blessed to see it. Huh? I wanted to set up to where that the taxi cabs from heaven all meet in the eastern parking lot and wait for the glory train. No, I want it to be that way because that'd be a symbol. Huh? He's coming from the eastern sky with the glory train to take us into heaven. They coming to go into heaven. You need to understand. They're not coming to just do your little patty cake game. I mean, I'm tired of people pinning the tail on a donkey. You know what I'm saying? People pinning the tail on a donkey in their conversations all the time. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You want me to break that down for you? I will, because I'm telling you right now, it's not a hyperbole. It's an example of what people have been doing. Hallelujah. I want you to get everything straightened out in God. See, everything is moving towards hallelujah, things of the Spirit. I mean, they had a great accomplishment in God because they brought a bunch of kids around, told them a little bedtime story, and fed them a hot dog after the meeting. Jesus. Come on. Father loves, despises, will have nothing to do with the arm of flesh and that which humans and the human realm produces. I hope that helps you. Those that are in the flesh cannot please God just as much as without faith. Those could say it like this: those who are in the flesh cannot please God, and those who are in the doubt are just the same. I'll say it again. I'll say it more perfectly. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God, and those who are in doubt are just the same. For with hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God, but you not in the flesh, but in the Spirit.
Amen.
And you not in
Amen.
Doubt, but you in faith.
Amen.
And any doubt comes around, I'm going to tell you right now, you shout it
Amen.
Down. You shout it down. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You shout it. Because you're fighting a good fight. You're warring a good warfare.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
See, those who are soldiers and called to be soldiers do not entangle themselves with the affairs of this life. We're going to have to make some progress with her little spirit. We're going to have to do it. We're going to have to make some progress with her. We want to see fruit. I found that corporal punishment, the belt, has a great way of changing people's attitudes and minds. When they're little children. And God told you guys to be converted and become like little children. I'm not going to line you up and spank you for wrongdoing. Praise God. Huh? But Papa wants to bring some correction that is far more effective than that which would be effective with the inability for her to understand the things we're trying to communicate to her and expect her to do. Please, in Jesus' name. Come on, people. Get things in divine order around your life. Don't allow chaos and strife and division and just whatever that just takes place. You just let it go no matter what it is. Bring things into line in agreement with the Spirit of the Lord. And here's what the Lord says. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Let your loins be girded with truth. Let your loins be girded about and your lights burning. Amen. Hallelujah. I've already preached a couple of times on that. I'm not going to go into that again. I got other things to say here. And ye yourselves like unto men that wait for the Lord. This is what the Father wants you to be. He wants you to be like men who are waiting for their Lord. From this day forward, from right on here, from here on in. Because now we're talking about you being faithful men, you agreeing with God and walking with God so that faith can be developed in your life, so the exploits of the very things that Jesus Christ did will be also done in you, so that heaven will be revealed in your life, because it's not going to happen any other way. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
This is not a little story that was told sometime long ago that we can all sit around and try to figure out what it means. This is God's command for the way that you and I are supposed to live and conduct our lives. In the name of Jesus, I mean, you get up in the morning and you get in the shower and you start washing yourself with the soap. It's time for you to start thanking God for the precious blood that has cleansed you and washed you for the washing of the water of the Word. I mean, it's time to get everything about God into whatever it is you're doing. It's time. Come on. Hallelujah. You start eating your eggs and bacon. You start thanking God for that heavenly manna, for the spiritual food that strengthens you. I mean, it's time to get God in the middle of what you're doing. Get out of your little whatever it is that's been going on up to this point. In Jesus' name, let's get some action around here. I'm tired of this slow growth curve. Doesn't look, it looks flatlined to me. In some people's lives, I'm sure there's probably some little change. It's just not barely measurable by the eyes of men. Praise God for His ability to perceive. Come on. This slothfulness is not a trait and characteristics of the Holy Ghost. Sloth, the slow-moving sloth. You need to have one of those, what are they called? Huh? Time-lapse cameras to see a movement in 12 hours. Please. 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 By this time next year, don't be doing what you've been doing for the past 10 years. Some of you. Please. Pretty please. The sugar on top. I beg you. I beseech you. Have mercy on the rest of us. Somebody said, well, I just don't know how to go after God. Poor you. It is an amazing thing. You don't know how to go after God when He's pursued you and gone after you. And you've got such models around you. Huh? And nobody can say that around here. You ain't saying, well, I tried. You tried wrong. You try right and it's going to work. Huh? If you're sinking, you're not swimming. Doesn't mean that you can't swim. You're not throwing your arms right. Jesus. I tried. It ain't working. Well, no person is hungry and thirsty. No one who agrees with God and who has faith in God and is willing to move with what Father has given you would ever say such a thing in the first place. Because you recognize God is not some liar who would promise you something and not fulfill it. It would rather create within your life a hunger and a desperation to get it right. You would recognize you're doing it wrong and you want to change. And now you're going to conform to the Word. Now you're going to start living the way God has demanded. Because there's a lot of people who got a bunch of nonsense excuses and I want to blow them all up. We want to crush them. So when you go looking for your excuses, you can find none. They are all lost. They're gone. They burned up. The pastor destroyed them. I had them here someplace. And be yourselves like unto men that wait for the Lord. That's who I'm going to be. When He will return from the wedding, that when He comes and knocks, they may open to Him immediately. sensitive to the moving of the Spirit. Yield. It's all about Him. We're just waiting on Him. We're waiting on the moving of the Holy Ghost. Come on, people, just agree with me in this. First and foremost, agree with God on what He wants His church to be. Agree with God on what He's purposed for you to be. Agree with God that He's given you the supernatural faith to be able to do these things, that He wants to develop them in you. All you have to do is be faithful with them. That faithfulness has with it a hunger and thirst. That faithfulness has with it a continuous seeking Him. For that's why faith is hooked up with seeking Him. Without faith, it is impossible to please God, because those that come to God must believe that He is, that He's here right now, and that He's a rewarder of those who diligently seeking Him. I'm telling you right now, faith and seeking God and active pursuit of that which Father has made available to us is inseparable from one another. Inseparable. And you're not going to go seeking God in spirit and truth to not have something and find something and get rewarded, because He is a rewarder. Don't forget it. He will supply it. He will develop it. He will bring everything into your life that needs to be in your life. He will adjust everything. He will perfect everything. So that we can move in this realm with Him. It's about a change that goes on in our lives. God doesn't need to change. No. And what He's doing doesn't need to be different. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when He comes, shall find watching. I'm just talking about faithfulness with what God has given. Faithfulness. Because He's like one who's gone, He's like a king who's gone on a long journey, who took those things which He had and He gave them to His stewards. He gave them to His servants and said, occupy until I come. And to one He gave five, and to another He gave two, and to another He gave one. And all, once again, all He's talking about is you and I being faithful with the things of the Holy Ghost, with the things of the Spirit, with the things of heaven, with the things of His ministry, with the things of His life, with the things of the display of His power and of His glory, His work of faith with power. If you want a model of a good steward, look at Jesus. You want a model of a good steward, look at Paul. If you want a model of a good steward, look at those who gave their whole life in service to the King. And when you give your whole life in the service of the King, you're going to look like the King. The majesty of the King will be there. This floodlight of heaven, of the Word of God, is shining right now. And God demands change. He demands change. Faith comes by the Word of God. You and I must hear the Word of God, obey the Word of God, and cooperate with the Word of God, live by the Word of God, speak the Word of God, think the Word of God, and not allow anything else in our lives. Otherwise, you're an unfaithful steward. You can't go standing in the line of the number who did something. You didn't do it. You didn't do it. Let's just do it. Amen. Let's just obey God. Amen. Let's understand the meaning of the parable. He's talking about you and I being willing to take up our cross, deny ourselves, and follow Him. He's not talking about some other kind of lifestyle. He's talking about what He's commissioned and ordained for us to do, to live out this wonderful, glorious realm of going everywhere, casting out devils, of living as lights unto the world, as shining with the glory of His presence, of moving in the power of the baptismal measure of the Holy Ghost, walking as the tabernacles of the Almighty God, where the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit abides and dwells. The ability to tread upon scorpions and serpents and all the power of the enemy, the very representatives of heaven conform to His image in every dimension of life. That's what these parables are about. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when He comes, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you, He shall gird Himself and make them sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. And if He shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, and find them so, blessed are those servants. And this know, that if the good men of the house had known that what hour the thief would have come, he would have watched and not have suffered his house to be broken through. Be therefore ready also, for the Son of Man comes at a time that you don't think. And that's just not talking about the end of time. That's talking about the end of our individual time. Because everybody's thinking that they're going to live longer. They're going to be able to have more opportunities. They're going to be able to do it later. Not today, tomorrow, maybe next week, maybe next year. It's going to be better conditions. Now. Now. Always being ready to give an account. It's what the parable of the 10 virgins is all about. That's what the parable of the stewards are all about. Just being ready always to give an account because your master's coming. Because he's given something to you that's so precious. He's given to you a measure of faith. He's given to you a gift of faith. He's given you the ability to start living out this wonderful, heavenly, glorious life. And please, if you just understand this relationship, the Father has designed this intimacy for you and me, is where we just begin to worship Him, we begin to praise Him, we begin to give thanks, we begin to, in every way, there have our hearts so yielded to Him that whatever He says, whatever He asks of us, we'll do it. Whatever things need to be changed in our life, we're not going to fight with Him on it. We'll just obey Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Haraboseti to Roma. Hatekina mositanania. I pray that you understand something about, just want to close and say these few things. I pray that you understand something about the language of the Spirit. If you're flowing in the language of the Spirit properly, what's going to be happening through it is you will access a deeper realm of the manifest presence of God, the glory of God. It will result in a boldness. It will result in a confidence for you to go do the things that God has told you to do. And that's why Jude said, which he's told all of us to do. Sometimes Father gives us specialized assignments, but it's within the big picture of what he said for us to do. And that's why Jude said, build up yourself in your most holy faith. Faith is the means by which we're going to get everything done that God has ordained for us to do. It's the means by which Jesus Christ is going to be revealed in us. It's the means by which the Holy Spirit is going to flow through us. It's the means by which we're going to grow. It's the means by which we're going to mature. It's the means by which every action of heaven will be displayed through our life. It's the means by which every interaction with Him will take place. Faith. And we have right now a measure of faith to be able to interact with Him and access by the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And as we interact with God and the Holy Spirit in this realm, who also is the one who activates the faith, makes the faith work, it gets stronger. So as you begin to pray in the Holy Ghost, let the Holy Spirit, let that prayer take you to a deeper realm of access, a deeper realm of yieldedness, a deeper realm of flow. If it doesn't happen that way, then you need to come and get some help. Because there's something wrong with that. Because I've watched too many people get sidetracked by the deceptions of the enemy. Because when God tells you to do something and you don't obey, the enemy has an opportunity then to sway you and to bring things into your life and to plant things there in your life that will hold you back. To some degree, there can be distractions, some degree deceptions, wrong thinking. You want to get this thing right. I pray in the Holy Ghost is a place, an understanding as a place to just be more yielded to God. And it makes a difference. With it, not only is there a greater yieldedness to the Spirit of the Lord and cooperation with the Spirit of the Lord, because it's activating cooperation with Him, but there comes a greater display then of the things of faith through my life, whether it's prophecy, ministry, whatever it is. Just a greater yieldedness. A greater yieldedness to God should bring a greater expression of heaven, manifest presence of God in your life. If that's not happening, then you want the Holy Spirit to come help you adjust those things. Sometimes it can be just in the realms of love. No, faith and love is supposed to always go together. You know that. There are so many people walk around in fear. Well, I was afraid that I was going to do it wrong. Fear. Well, I was then afraid. I didn't feel. And the intimidation factor, the self-conscious factor, all fear. Well, love get rid of all that for you. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to show you how. And He's given you faith to cooperate with Him. He's given a measure of faith to cooperate with Him. But if you're not going to be faithful in it, it's never going to develop. Faithfulness sometimes is staring down defeat. It seems like an inescapable defeat. Faith is standing there being unwilling to be moved by fear. Faith is standing there and being bold, saying, no matter what happens, I will stand here no matter what takes place. I will pursue this no matter what it looks like. I don't care what the outward appearances of things or circumstances may be. I will not let up. When it doesn't change the bar, it doesn't change the outcome, it doesn't change the command, it doesn't change the consecration, it doesn't change the commitment. Building up yourself in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God. Faith and love is always there together. Huh? Faith that works by love. Many people have not profited from tongues because they don't walk in love. Oh yeah. And when you begin to break it down like 1 Corinthians chapter 13, you can discover where people don't do that, where there's this, you know, there are so many different displays. When you begin to let the Holy Spirit shine His floodlight of heaven in there, you begin to give yourself over to the Word of God and say, search me, O Lord. Then God, the Holy Spirit, can show you what nobody else can show you. Because when you're deceived, nobody can convince you of the truth, not even God. It's true. But if you begin to give yourself over to the Word of God and to the examination of the Lord, He in His mercy and His grace, He'll melt right through those things, huh, that have become strongholds in your life. God is good.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
You know, the worst thing I could possibly imagine is that I had any kind of stronghold in my life. The worst thing that I could possibly imagine is that I have any kind of deception in my life. The worst thing I could possibly imagine if I have any place in my life that is not yielded to God. But you know what? There has to be those kinds of places in my life. Otherwise, the full flow of the majesty of heaven would be demonstrated through my life. So I want to understand wherever it is I'm not yielded. Wherever it is that there's any kind of interference, I'm allowing any of the enemy to run any interference in my life that's keeping me back. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to see some lavish worship in my life. You're going to see some lavish praise. You're going to see some lavish moving. You're going to see some lavish exploits. Amen. So don't get too comfortable. Thinking the pastor's in the same situation I'm in. Because I'm not. I'm not sitting there. Are you listening to me? And my desperate cry for you is that you're not sitting there either. We love you. We love seeing you, staring at your face. But there's millions of people that would also like to see your face if your face is lit up with the glory of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father wants to make you fisher of men. Wherever you go, everybody who wants truth and wants God, they'd be collected by you. You collected you a net. No true seekers can swim through here. No hungry people for God can swim through here.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bishambratan in a kishi palananamanda. Hallelujah. Is there anybody in here tonight you're not convinced of the love that God has for you? Is there anyone here tonight? Perhaps you're not convinced of the love that God has for you. Because there's no question of God's love for the world. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. That if God so loved us, that when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, He commended that love towards us. That if He spared not His own Son, but offered Him up for the sins of us all in that condition that we were in. Is everybody in this place convinced of God's love for you? Because that's where it's got to start. But then there has to be a reciprocation of that love. God demands an obedience. God demands us to be conformed to His way. You'll never stop His love. His love will always reach to you, but His love will not His love will not transgress your will. His love will not make you do anything. Will you respond to His love?
Yes.
Will that love response begin to be something where God can make real to you, all that He's done for you, all of His abundance that He gives to you, all of His blessings that He daily loads you with, so that all of a sudden you begin to find the reality of thanksgiving and praise within your life. Because some people, when they begin to worship, they look like they're having to eat okra. Boiled okra. It has got to be the worst food that I know of. Boiled okra. I'm not kidding you. When some people worship, it looks like that they're having to eat their vegetables that they do not like. If you want to know who you are, just ask. I'll tell you. I say, yeah, you an okra eater. And you say, oh, no, I'm not. And I say, oh, yes, you are, because you're the only one who's convinced you're not, because to me, you look like an okra eater. You can believe that you're not. Oh, that's not you. And everybody's just picking on you. Nobody loves you. Or can you just recognize that you really look like that? And we are earnest to see you be different. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're interested in seeing you get happy about Jesus.
Amen.
Interested in seeing you get excited about the things of God. Interested in seeing you get excited about the offering of your life.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because you're just so thankful for His love. You begin to respond to His love. If you're not going to get intimate with God, He's not going to get intimate with you. If you're going to withhold from God, He's going to withhold from you. If you draw nigh to God, He's going to draw nigh to you. If you resist God, He's going to resist you. And that then begins to open up a whole other dimension of things, doesn't it? Because He gives grace to those who are broken and walk in humility. You know one, a person who walks in humility? A person you say, this is what you're supposed to do, and they say, yes, I'll go do it. No problem, yes, sir. A person who walks in pride, they're going to argue with you. Every time they're going to argue with you, and they're going to say, that's not true, it's not that way. That's pride. God said, I resist the proud. And you could simply say, God said, I resist the arguer. The person who's going to argue, who's going to defend themselves and uphold what they believe about themselves. Why would you want to have self-righteousness when you could have His righteousness? Why not just say, Lord, forgive me, I don't want to be that way. Oh, when you believe the love that God has for you, all of a sudden you believe the love that everybody else has for you that loves God. Because everyone who loves the one who beget also loves those who are begotten.
Amen.
Oh, what a love. What a place to live in. Let tongues profit you. Because tongues has the very love and expression of God there, hallelujah, the language of the Spirit. Let it excel. Let it strengthen you. Let it excel. Let it teach you how, by the Holy Ghost, to live in a greater dimension of yieldedness. Listen, people, we have to have an encounter with Jesus. There's got to be a greater encounter with Jesus. I know no any other way of encountering Him and interacting with Him like the display of worship and praise and thanksgiving. I understand this from the Scripture. I'm just beckoning. I'm calling you to come. I'm calling you to come to understand that there's nothing more important than you and I learning how to yield to Him. Because there is the place now that we can begin to interact with Him so that we can faithfully keep those things, that precious thing, that blessed thing that He's given to us called faith. And it can then now be developed, it can be activated. We give ourselves to it in every dimension, in every beginning with that intimacy. Faith for relationship. Stand with me. Say, I have faith.
I have faith.
For relationship.
For relationship.
I have faith.
To access heaven.
To interact with God.
Wow.
Wow. On Monday morning when no one's around. On Tuesday evening when I'm worn out. And I just feel like laying here staring at the ceiling. Don't read a book. Touch heaven. Don't get preoccupied with a conversation with men. Get in a conversation with God. Who would you rather talk to? Me or God? Of course. One person knew. I only heard one person say God, and that was a whisper. Should I say it again? Who would you rather talk to, me or God?
God!
And I hope that the Lord didn't say, oh, really? I hope He didn't say that when you said that. He's just good to us. He loves us. And He wouldn't say that. You know why? Because He's just so good. He's amazing. It's almost like He'll take what He can get. Huh? I hate to even put that on the Father, that anybody would even think of treating Him that way. But He's just so full of love that He's captivated and fully involved in the whatever time we give Him. Come, let us worship the Lord. Come, let us worship and bow down. Can you imagine that? Would that be lost to the church? Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Savior. Could that possibly be lost to the church? Oh, I want to dance, I want to shout, but I want to bow and I want to kneel. And I don't want it just to be in a context of the church, though the church is the context where it should be most glorious. I want to prepare myself so that in the context of the church, it will be most glorious. Come on now. You're already ready. Got to be ready. Be on time with God. I can tell you without any question that Joshua gives himself to be ready for the meeting. He waits upon the ministry. People say, I don't know how to flow. Well, why don't you go to the place where you can learn? Intimacy with God. So that we can bring our best. We can bring our best bow. Come, let us worship. We can bring our best worship. We can come and kneel. We can bring our best kneel. There's a place to walk with God where He'll bear you up. I was walking backwards like this the other day, and I missed a concrete step. And I fell quite a ways onto a concrete ground. But the angels caught me. And imagine what happens when you miss a step, right? People saw it happen. They thought I twisted my ankle and busted my neck. No. I'm walking in heaven. I'm walking in heaven. I'm about my papa's business. People, come on now. Father wants to do something in our lives. It's so glorious. And He can't do it unless we're willing to become those who are yielded to Him, separated to Him. People ask Wigglesworth, how do you do it? I stay yielded. People ask Branham, how do you do it? I stay yielded. I want people to be able to ask you, how do you do it? And you respond to it, I stay yielded. Come, let us worship and bow down. Come, let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. For He is our God. And we are His people and the sheep of His hand. Whew. Whew. Hallelujah. There's a place that God would call you that you can come into where He will show you how to let the expressions of His life and power begin to be released from you as though it were like rivers. It will be explosive displays of His power. I tell you, you should want to learn. I tell you, I want to go there. I'm going to give myself a greater passion to live there, to be there. People, God's just calling us. He's calling us. But there's going to be troops. There's going to be walls. There's going to be obstacles. There's going to be situations that feel like, make you feel like I'm going to just give up. It just ain't going to work. It just seems too much. Seems like I'm not in the plan. Seems like I'm somehow left out. Seems like somehow it ain't working out. That's where faithfulness makes a stand and says, I should not be moved. That's where the good fight of faith stands up and begins to war, good warfare. That's where you begin to contend. That's where your eyes change colors. Yeah. And you look terrifying. Thank you, Father, for your love. Thank you, Father, for your love. People, tonight, is to say, I just want you to understand, I'm learning how to more accurately flow with the Holy Ghost. I'm learning how not to miss Him. He's perfect. He's a good teacher, but we've got to be yielded. We've got to be engaged. We have to be involved. You can begin to be faithful just reaching the lost by making your car a taxi cab to heaven. Giving yourself to reaching one lost soul. Beginning to say, oh, cry out to God, oh God, give me a soul. Oh God, let me begin to move in your glory, in your faith, in your power so one person's life can be changed through my life. Then you just go ahead and take it up to 10. Then you can take it up to 100. Then you can take it up to 1,000. Then you can take it up to 10,000. Then go ahead and move it on into 100,000. Come on, this is see faith developing through faithfulness, through commitment. Not by trying to go to 100,000 when you haven't gotten one. Just right what God has given you, right where you're at right now, you begin to focus faith and the anointing. Don't forget the context. Don't forget the context. A new creation who no longer lives for themselves, who hates their life in this world, who having set their hand to the plow does not look back or think about other alternatives. One who is a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Not conformed to the world or to their culture. But transfigured by the renewing of their mind because they think according to God's thoughts, according to what God says in His Word. Look at the context. Who are devoted to understanding and moving in the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The most important thing to you and me. Because the world will pass away and the lust thereof, but they that do the will of God will endure forever. A man saw heaven. A man saw heaven. A man saw heaven. And his description was it too much different from a lot of what is we record in the book of Enoch in some respects. And I really believe his testimony. I'm not going to tell you what his name is because of the great exploits, the great signs and wonders that God did through his life. There's no doubt that he saw Jesus. He visited with Jesus. He was taken up into the third heaven as Paul was. And there was the exploits of God in his life. Because when you have those kinds of encounters, when you have an encounter with Jesus, I'm going to tell you right now, the life of God is going to be expressed through our lives in a way that goes beyond where we're at now. Even though we've been born again, even though we've been filled with the Spirit, even though he's come to tabernacle in us, there is a something that the Lord wants to have in our life. He says, I'll come and manifest myself to you. I believe that goes beyond just the general corporal outpouring of the Spirit of God. There's something Father wants us to have. I'm going after it. We've got to strive for it lawfully. There's a faithfulness in it and having it. And he said, it wasn't really different from being out in the country of Montana and Alaska. He spent a lot of his life there. He said, I stepped over and it was still the beautiful splendor of the vast mountain ranges. Just everything was perfectly clean and pure. And he talked about the multitudes of people that were there, and he just reached out and he physically touched them. He literally pinched himself so he could really know whether he was there in the body or in the spirit. He did a couple of things so that he knew, I was there in the body, I was there. You know, I hear people talk about that. I want that. I want to do that. I want to step over into that realm. I love stepping over into the realm of just praise and worship and prophecy. I love that. As we were worshiping the Lord tonight and the Spirit of the Lord, it's us allowing. I just allow the Holy Ghost to flow through me, and I begin to sing and express those things by the Spirit of the Lord. As it's also this morning, I just love that realm because it's heaven. It's heaven. Why would we do anything else when we can do heaven? Why would we do any other kind of worship when we can have worship that's heavenly? Amen. Why would we do anything else? When God has purposed to cause the good pleasure of his goodness to be fulfilled in our lives with the work of faith and power, why would we want to do anything else? Why would we give ourselves to torment, to agony, to failure, to defeat, to doubt, to unbelief, to uncertainty, when we can have great confidence and boldness and expectation? If you've got to fast and pray to get to this realm, I suggest you do it. If you're not in this realm, you better do whatever it needs you to do to get in this realm, because I'm telling you right now, God's not a liar nor a respecter of persons. And anybody who faithfully will seek him, I'm telling you right now, you're going to be rewarded with the same kind of outpouring of the Spirit of God of these men and these few men and these few women that we would talk about, who went all the way with God and didn't hold anything back, who conformed themselves to the word and to the way. I'm telling you, listen, if I've not been an example of that, I'm going to be a better one. If you haven't seen a complete surrender and consecration of passionate worship in my life, hang on, it's coming. Hang on. If you've not seen the gifts of the Spirit being displayed through me, I promise you. Just wait. You won't have to wait long. We've taken hold of what God has made available. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. And I pray in Jesus' name, every one of you will come to understand what it means to be captivated by his presence. If you get captivated by his presence, if you get raptured in him, you won't even know what you're doing. You won't even know what you're doing when you go to prophesying. You won't even know what you're doing, won't even care. You're so caught away in God, you're like a drunk person. You won't even care. Whew. You won't even care what it looks like. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We love you, people. We love you, people. We love you, people. We love you. We love you. We love you. God loves you so much. But we're not going to stand back and watch you congratulate yourself when you're not flowing in the gifts of the Spirit. When you're not flowing in the dimensions of the glory of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, which God commands. We're going to get aggravated, seriously aggravated with you. If you're broken before God, and all you're just going to do is be broken before God, say, I just want this. You know, I'm not going to be aggravated. God, the Holy Ghost, isn't going to be aggravated. But if you're standing there going, you know, I'm good. I feel I'm doing just a fine thing. And I'm so satisfied with the way I am. I like me so much, I can't imagine you don't. Then we're going to be aggravated. You listen to me. You hear me? All we want, all God wants, all we need is brokenness before Him. Neediness. It ain't going to be long, and we're going, one way or the other, we're going to step over and we're going to see that land, and we're going to discover it's not much different from here. It's just everything's beautiful and perfect and hallelujah and pure and glorious. Does it sound good to you that in the realms of heaven you can spend all your time around the throne of God, beholding His glory, seeing the majesty and the splendor of who He is, and being caught away in the praises and caught away in the ecstasy of life? Whew. The ecstasy of life, which I've touched in prophecy, which I've touched in praise. Listen, understand this. I'm really thinking that I just want to get you hold of this to you, this access by faith, this access by faith, this access by the Spirit. I've never touched heaven like I've touched heaven through praise and worship and thanksgiving and prayer. I've never touched it. That's the place. That's the place. That's where I get so filled up that then I can move in these other dimensions of the glory of God. And if you're not willing to do these things, I don't believe you'll ever experience what God has for you. I don't believe you'll ever know what it means to be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. I don't believe you'll ever know what it means to be prepared by God in every good work. These Bubba's just calling us to a realm of heaven. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Oh, come, let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. Oh, that we may see Him, behold Him in Zion. Oh, that there comes a cry in our heart, a passion in our heart, a desperation in our heart, a seeking God in our heart, where we both day and night begin to call out to Him and say, oh God, let me know this realm. I just want to know this realm. I'm not going to be shut out of this realm. I know this realm is available. I'm not going to doubt. I'm not going to believe. I know You gave me a measure of faith to enter into this realm, because it's what the measure of faith is all about. Faith is about relationship. Faith is not about some religion. Some faith is not about this thing or that thing. It's about knowing You. It's about knowing You. It's about interacting with You, being one with You, fellowshipping with You. Have access by faith into His presence. That we work supernatural things through our life as we know Him, as we know Him, as we encounter Him. Oh, I've got to have this. I've got to have what, Father, what must I do? What changes, what adjustments must be made in my life? And I just hear Him say over and again, worship me. Just come. Come, 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 sit here at my feet. Come here. Come over here. Come know me. Come know me. Come know me. Come know me. Come behold me. Miraro mamosito rimanda de bekite la dona mombre de bashishi. People, I'm going to be here for 2 weeks without interruption. I mean, I'm going to try to be here longer, but I'm going to be here for at least 2 weeks without interruption. Come press on it. Come press in with me, please. Come press in with me, please. Come press in. I'm telling you right now, you listen to me. I will be a battering ram in the kingdom of God. I will bust through every hindrance. I'm not going to sit passively by, waiting for some other day, waiting for some other event. Because I know that the movings of God are always available. I want you to come and know it with me. We're going to be here on Wednesday night. We'll be here on Friday night. Just seeking Him. Seeking Him. Seeking Him. Seeking Him. Flow of heaven. Oh, babasita rababaraniya. Shikarada namasakita. Seeking Him. Seeking Him. Seeking Him. Seek You. Father, we seek You. Lord Jesus, we seek You. We desire You above everything else. We desire You, God. We want You and You alone, Your ways, Your glory, Your presence, Lord. Lord, we don't want to know about You. We want to know You. Say, Lord, I don't want to know about You. I want to know You. Show me how. I'm yielded now. I'm lovesick. I'm desperate. I will not let go till I have more of You, Lord. And then I'll be desperate still. I will not let go until I know You, Lord. And then I'll hunger still. This week, I'm going to have a meeting with everybody who's interested, everybody who's already doing something in homeschooling, but everybody who's interested in being a part of doing something even more. I believe that if there is a way to grab a hold of children's hearts and be a part of their education, and there's not a more desperate time than now. I was just in Connecticut, and this isn't a unique thing. And, you know, I have parents coming to me, what can we do? We have to homeschool our kids, and we don't know how to do it. Do you have any suggestions? I was just with Phil and Sharon recently, you know, we were in South Africa, or forgive me, in Zambia. And they said, you know, we were sending our kids to a Christian school, and we got so tired of them being around Holy Ghost fighters. People trying to tell them things that are opposite of what we believe. We said, just pull them out, set them in front of a computer. And I believe that Father is going to give us wisdom and insight on how to do these things differently in a unique way that brings to bear the opportunity of the hour, insight and wisdom that comes from heaven. Something that's unique from heaven that won't be, you know, localized in a specific region. Josh was already involved in something, and a few other people here in the church, of what Joe and Becky are doing in their music school online. Somebody said, "Well, the Abeka system has an education online that's interactive." Yeah, well, I'm gonna tell you right now, I'm not interested in Abeka doctrine and what they're doing, but we could see the Lord do something so unique. And the Father's given me some wisdom and given me some insights on how to do this. And if you want to participate in it, just come. Geneva is supposed to be organizing the meeting. I know she had to go out of town for the weekend. But I want to reach people on every level, any way possible. There's people in here, God's trained you and you've had ability. God's given you opportunities, I should rather say, to become educators. And it's a staff, as it were, in your hand. Something that's in your hand. And there's an opportunity to reach hundreds of thousands of kids. And you say to the Lord, well, I don't want to do it that way. Well, that's pretty silly. Huh? You will rather want to say, Lord, I'll do whatever, any way, whatever way. Use me. Show me any way and every way that I can impact people's lives. I'm be in it. Hallelujah. I can imagine. You talk about, I believe God would give us insight to create businesses that serve ministry. It's true. To where, just imagine that God would give us the insight and the abilities. Because this is a faith realm. And if you haven't developed faith, I can understand how you might be cringing right now. But I understand faith. Where you can begin to do things and God will show you how to do it. And it will explode. And Father, I know His purpose and His breathing on this thing. To be able to create businesses to serve ministry. To where that everybody's involved in such a thing. You know, they're all, everything they're doing is all about ministry. It's reaching the lost. And there's also enough finances to take care of their needs, of their financial needs, their livelihood. Huh? Praise God. My first objective would be to go preach the gospel to reach a lost and dying generation of kindergarten through high school. Hey? Using the World Wide Web and the internet and virtual school to do it. Yeah. I mean, we have a lot of people in here with a lot of talent and ability. We have a lot of people in here with graduate degrees. Come on, I mean, think about it. Come on. There's no reason why we can't grab a hold of the anointing to be pace setters in education. To where that everybody who goes through our program makes higher scores on the standardized testing than anybody else in the nation. Amen. To where that the high school students that go through our program make higher SAT scores than anybody in the nation. There's ways to design it. And people who've labored in education and labored in graduate degrees. We have many people in here with doctorate degrees. We know the drill. We know what you got to do to be successful. And begin to let God show us now, take that to another level. Hallelujah. And have plans that don't just do mathematics, but helps people understand that Satan fell before Adam did and how Satan fell. And what are the scriptures about that? Taken from Genesis all the way through, huh? Is one of the classes required? Amen. In every one of the, and it won't be long. Just imagine. See, I think 10, 15, 20 years down the road. I don't think next month. That's just the way God made me. I don't think about what it's going to look like next year. Next year is probably going to be hellacious, challenging, grueling, tasking. You know what I'm saying? Opposition, right, left, and center. Sweat, blood, and tears. But 10, 15 years from now, come on, you think about it. It's explosive. And nothing good come just hand out. You labor for it. You work for it. Hallelujah. Fight for it. So if you're interested in hearing more about that, a memo is going to go out. Hallelujah. Ann and I are going to be there. Unless she's with baby. baby into baby, baby who's having a baby. And everybody who's involved in doing anything with the program that we have right now, they're going to be there. They have to be there. Because that's going to, we've got to change that. And it has to be changed. Amen.
Amen.
If we don't teach people how to go after excellence and strive for excellence, I'm going to tell you right now, we're not teaching anything about the nature of God. We're not teaching anything about what I just talked about here tonight in faith and being faithful. And we demand it. There's ways to set it up. And I know many of you know very clearly, you know, you understand. But you've got to get the big picture. You've got to understand the big picture of the thing.
Yes.
I was telling someone the other day, I said, you can go to a prep school for Harvard in high school. And you can have a 4.8 GPA. You can have 5.0 GPA. But the bottom line of it is you're going to take an SAT test. And if Junior from Podunk Hick School out in, you know what I'm saying, Podunk Hick High School scores higher in the SAT, you're behind him. And you design and begin to just think about how you design everything around the ultimate objective. Yeah. Hallelujah. Shika Ramandaya. Set new standards. I mean, why not go after everything? Can you do it? What is it that you can't do? What is it that you can't do?
Nothing.
What is it that you can? I can do, personally, I can do all things. See, Christ who strengthens me. Personally, I'm in a realm called faith where the impossible is always, it's just no problem. Say, the impossible?
Impossible.
No problem.
No problem.
How big can you think? Think bigger. How big can you dream? Dream bigger. How much can you do? Do more. We dreamers.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. When I get to be a real old guy, and I can't really move around very well, I'm going to have a university of biblical studies. But when I get to be real old, well, I can't move around anymore, then very much. I got to kind of stay in one general location. I got plans, huh? Mama doesn't want me limiting myself. Okay, baby. You've got me always moving around. I'm just kind of, forgive me for thinking like everybody else thinks. Thanks, baby.
Moses, he did great at 80. You're going to do great.
He did great at 120.
I know, see?
So, there you go. At 80, he was like a young man.
Right.
I mean, I'm just getting help. She's being the helper of my faith right now. I'm not fighting it. You see that? I'm not fighting that at all. I'm like, yeah, okay, come on. Amen. I'm hooking up with that.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. We were with a guy just recently, a pastor up in North Dakota. Sweet. Wonderful model of a man of God, just walking in humility and brokenness. Beautiful man of God. He was in his 80s. So his wife, what, right? The Lord showed him he's going to live to be 120. I mean, just so fit. Divine health, living in the glory. Divine health. My sharp thinking. On the edge of his seat the whole time I was preaching. He was. It's true. Of course, that's God thing. That's not me. I take no credit for it. Jesus. Surita ra ramambra te sika. Mindandare de ki pishti koroda. signs and wonders and miracles. Great exploits. A mentality, a way of thinking that says nothing is impossible. What? We can do that. Anything. You name it, we can do it. Huh? Just tell us what it looks like, we'll go get her done. Just tell her where it, point us in the right direction, and we'll go make a move of God of the thing. We'll go do signs and wonders in Jesus' name. We'll bring heaven. We think that we got to have all the stuff. No, I tell you, I found this over and again. Brittany, listen, I want everybody to understand this. I can sit down with a person in a restaurant and start talking to them, and heaven will come. How much more in a meeting? We think we got to have all this lineup of stuff. I want heaven. I don't want the lineup. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Why have singing if you don't have heaven? Why have preaching if you don't have heaven? Why have anything if you don't have heaven? Why have prayer if I can't feel heaven? Yeah. It's a demand that we place upon ourselves because God has already commanded it. It's the adjustments that we make in our life. It's our heart and our desperation for Him that we don't compromise. We don't compromise. In Jesus' name. Father, we thank You that You're going to use Your daughter Leslie in a mighty way to touch many children throughout the United States of America and the world. You know, a huge majority of kids in Japan sit isolated in their houses. They don't go anywhere. They just stare at their computer. Many of the people in Japan, they're lost for how to captivate the kids and get them educated. What if you created a model that ultimately could be translated into Japanese and it just takes the place by storm? By every means, by any means possible, we're going to reach the lost. We're going to touch the nation. You touch the children and you've touched the nation. You change the children, you've changed the nation. You find the breeding ground for greatness and for champions among children. That you demand those things of them. Faith does exploits. Faith quenches the violence of fire. Faith commands the Son of Man. Faith speaks to the mountains, and they obey. Faith moves like God moves. Faith produces the majesty and the splendor, the presence and the glory of God upon our lives. It's time to start moving in faith. It's time to start giving yourself to the realms of faith. Faith lays hold of the movings of God. Faith brings revival to a nation. Faith brings heaven to those who've only known hell. Faith breaks the darkness and causes the light of God's glory to shine. Faith turns the hearts of men, the atmosphere of men, from Satan to God, from darkness to light. Faith lays hold of promises. Faith changes nations and the courses of time. The course of time subdues nations, puts the armies of aliens to flight. the enemies of God. Faith. Faith has access into His presence. Faith has Father's ear and attention.
Yes.
Faith moves heaven. Far greater feet than moving mountains. Jesus. Faith changes hearts, changes lives, makes straight twisted limbs, opens blinded eyes. Faith raises the dead to life again, brings hope to those who had none, who had given completely up. Faith. Come seek the Lord with me. Come wait upon Him with me. Come find how easy it is to experience His precious presence. Come understand how beautiful it is to enter in. To all of His good pleasure. The good pleasure of His goodness. Faith takes us to meet with Fidel Castro and Raul to begin to have inroads into Cuba. God has given me a plan, inroads for Cuba. Faith lays hold on it. And when Satan comes with all of his discouragements and all of his lies and says it cannot be and tries to make you feel hopeless and tries to make you want to give up for no reason at all, you're unmoved by it. You're untouched by it. Because you have the whole armor of God upon you, the very glory of heaven surrounding you. And it cannot access your heart or your emotions or your decision making. It inspires a laugh. A greater consecration. In confidence that it will be done.
Yes, Lord.
That His will, will be done. That His will be done. Faith has more influence than any other influence. More skill than any other skill, more ability than any other ability, more power than any other power. Faith. Faith takes a few loaves and fishes and feeds a multitude. Faith raises the dead to life again. Faith prepares for me an immortal body just like His. Faith has inscribed my name and engraved it. Upon His hands and in His book, has written it in heaven, has prepared for me a body eternal in the heavens. Faith. 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 The measure of faith that is given to every man which Father has purposed should increase so that you become full of faith. That you do great exploits among the people. They saw Stephen, and what did they saw about? What did they see about Stephen? What did they see about Stephen? Huh? What did they see about Stephen? He was full of faith and wisdom. Who did? Great signs. Huh? And miracles among the people. He's no different. You're no different. None. But his commitment that he had was testified to when he was willing to be stoned to death. Do you hear? People want to have that without the commitment. The commitment lays hold. The abandonment lays hold on that. Come, let us worship and bow down. Come, let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. Should we lose that? Let praise be extravagant. Let praise be the offering of that which is precious to you. That which is costly. That which is your best, that which is your treasure. Sandy and James, would you come here with your families? Come stand here. I want to pray for you guys. Faith gets excited when no one shows up. Because it recognizes it's about to break through. Huh? The signs and wonders and exploits. Doesn't get discouraged. Faith doesn't get discouraged. Faith encourages itself. Faith speaks to the barren womb and life fills it. Faith lays hold on promises. Faith does miracles. Father, we thank you that our little sister will walk in the fullness of health. The fullness of your spirit. That everything about our little life, our spirit, soul, and body, and mind, absolutely like you designed when you shaped and formed man in your image and your likeness. That every miracle that can be experienced by the sister. In Jesus' name, I command this body In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. To develop. To be in every way perfect. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, it will be so. Put your hands towards heaven right now. Quit being a brat. In the name of Jesus, you have a right spirit now in Jesus' name. An obedient spirit. Now in Jesus' name. Lift your hands a little bit higher. You don't seem yielded enough. Obey. Say obey. Say obey. Say obey. Can you say that? Say yes. Say spanking. Katie, come here. We want to pray for you. Katie, come here. We want to pray for you. I don't know where you are. Come here. We want to pray for you. Just come. Just go over there. Stand. Lift your hands towards heaven. Just quietly minister to her some, dear Allie. See, the gifts of the Spirit are here right now. They're operating right now. Divine empowerment's here right now for anybody to receive. But unless you have a vision of what you're going to do with that divine empowerment, it won't be able to come to you. There's no way for you to be yielded to it because you don't need it. What would you do with it? You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Father wants you to get busy about the Master's business. There's the gifts of the Spirit right now that are here available so that you can flow and operate in the body of Christ. But there needs to be love in your spirit and a compassion in your spirit. It needs to be seated with prayer for the people around you. And then you're yielded to it because you're seated with prayer, compassion from people around you. You're concerned for their needs and responsible for their well-being. Now, the Spirit of the Lord can just flow through you. Give you wisdom, words of knowledge, words of discerning of spirits. Thank you, Jesus. Sitting right there. Sit right there. Go ahead and receive. Catherine, come here. Come here. Come to me. Stand there. Bold faith. Not pray in Jesus' name, God give you supernatural rest and recognize that you have to get up early in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, to go to work. Just recognize Papa sees it. He does not lightly regard those things that are so difficult for us, because he knows. He understands. It's a big deal to him when we put him first. It is a big deal to Father when you put him first. He does not take it for granted. It's a big deal to him. Father, I thank you for the gifts of healing. I thank you for the gifts of healing, signs and wonders and miracles displayed to your daughter's life. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the supernatural power of the Holy Ghost, for the working of faith. Thank you, Father, for this complete and total healing. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you're here with us right now. You're doing these things. Faith! Margaret, come here. You bring Jaden. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Where are your shoes? Huh? Okay, yeah. Shoes are good. Jesus. Father, I thank you for a great display of heaven and of your glory through your daughter, Margaret, through your servant. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the privilege and the access we have by faith to be able to touch the realms of heaven. Huh. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the privilege that we have to interact with you in such a way that your manifest presence fills the place. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Take hold of Jaden's life, Lord. Take hold of Jaden. Take hold of Jaden. Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Annalyn, you stay right there where you at. The glory of God's all over you. The presence of, and the favor of God's right there. The forming power, the Spirit of the Lord that shapes everything about a great woman of God is taking place in your life. Just right there. Right there and there. Beautiful realm of yieldedness. That's it. Just a beautiful realm of yieldedness that you learn from worship. Just a beautiful realm of yieldedness. And it doesn't seem like sometimes in that place that all of your prayers are being answered and all of your desires and all your requests are being heard, but they are. God's shaping it. He's forming it. He is. He's forming exploits and miracles. He's forming within our lives an absolute consecration to know that what He's promised and what He's said, He's also willing and able to do it. Faith is inseparable from faithfulness. It's inseparable. Same words. By and large, it's really the same word. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Just don't hold on to anything. So I said, how can I be to that so? How can I give myself over to with such abandonment to the Lord like that? Don't hold on to anything. Don't withhold any part of you. Yourself from Him. It's kind of like just getting lost in His love. Just being so captivated by His love that you're just carried away. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Whoever it was that was over in this area getting really loud with the language of the Spirit during worship, when that language comes that you had, who was that? It was several of you. When that language comes, just let the praise flow too. If you just make it praise, you won't get all overwhelmed thinking, well, if I say praise, it seems like easier to have than prophecy. You know what I'm saying? It's like saying, she's only asleep rather than dead. Hey, that's nonsense. That's total nonsense. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you for all the miracles you've done in little Anna's body. And Lord, we just thank you that the appetite increases in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Signs and wonders and miracles, yes, in Jesus' Lord. Name.
Yes. Yes.
And every old afflicting and tormenting thing that tried to harass this baby, I'll break it in Jesus' name. I'll break its power. Destroy it now. The authority of the word of Jesus. The authority of the word of the Spirit. Anyone else tonight, you troubled in your heart and troubled in your life, dealing with some kind of problem in your body? Some need, some petition you have before the Lord that you seem stuck with. We want to be helpers of your faith. We can't produce faith in you. The Word of God produces faith. God gives a measure of faith. Every time you obey the word, hear the word of God, and obey the word of God, faith grows and develops in your life. Every time you move with God faithfully, stand fast and see the thing happen, faith grows in your life. But we can be helpers of your faith. We can hook up with your faith. Every time Jesus ministered healing, it was always about faith. Don't fear, have faith. Says it to us again and again. You know, the Lord says over 360 times, close to 370 times, do not fear, fear not. Do not have fear. He wants us to have great boldness and confidence. The Lord wants us to be fearless. Amen. The point should be well established after 360 times. I'm not kidding you. Put in your Google search engine, whatever, you know. Fear not. And you'll see it well over 400 times, probably 460, 470, 480. But when you sort through it, when it's the Lord talking directly to us about fear not, to his servants, be about 360, 370 times. We need to obey him.
Amen.
But on your own, we cannot do that. Because our natural response to adversity is going to be fear. But we don't need to live in a natural response. We can live yielded to God, the Holy Spirit, and have a divine response. I promise you, it's another kind of life to live, and I want you to learn to live it, says the Lord. He's devoted and consecrated. He's given to us the healing flow, the healing stream of the blood of Jesus. The healing stream. The flow of the Holy Ghost. I was thinking this morning as I stood in front of Michaela, who I don't know what all of her problem was. I know what Michaela's problem is from a physical point of view, why she can't walk properly. But I heard the Lord said if she would just come and sit in my presence, just stay in my presence. I heal her. She came. All she wanted to pray for to be healed of is anxiety. It's anxiety. Michaela will have no anxiety ever again in the name of Jesus. And so you say and you agree, and you're participating with the miracle. Don't be left out. The only person who's going to decide for you to be left out is your silence. You're unwilling to follow and participate. Don't do that. Don't do that. I beg you, please quit it. Stop it. In the name of Jesus. You know what you delight in? Things that cooperate with you. Things that listen to you and obey you within the realms of your influence, like your puppy dog. Or maybe your children. Or your husband. What Father likes is when we participate with him and cooperate with him. He delights in it. So do that. Don't do your own thing. Do his thing. Jesus. There's no reason for anybody to leave here tonight with pain, sickness, fear, torment, or lack. Because faith is here. There's no reason. If you leave here tonight with any of those things, it's because you've decided to. It's because you've purposed in your heart to do it. It's because somehow, somewhere, you're not willing to cooperate with God and participate with Him and follow Him. So I say in the name of Jesus, quit being like that. Stop it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let the weak say I'm strong. Let the poor say I'm rich. Let the sick say I'm healed. Say, Jesus, look at what the Lord has done for me. Hallelujah. I love the presence of Jesus. I pray that every one of you will determine in your heart and in your life that you're never going to feel bad again. Because it's hard to yield to the Spirit of the Lord when you feel bad. I've determined to feel good. It's the fruit of the Spirit. Goodness. Feeling good. Someone said faith should never follow your feelings, but your feelings should follow your faith. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Someone more accurate than that said, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. So we're just going to stay in the realms of faith. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Doubt and unbelief is such an enemy of the work of Jesus and the ministry of Jesus, isn't it? Why couldn't we cast out this devil? Because of your unbelief. Why couldn't we flow in your ministry, Lord Jesus? Because of your unbelief. Why didn't these people see the power of God exercised through Emily? Because of your unbelief. Do you know how to have faith developed in your life? Faithfulness. Say faithfulness. You want to know the greatest place to develop it? Fellowship. Intimacy. And worship. Touch in heaven. Don't forget it. Don't forget it. Do not forget this between tonight and Wednesday night. Do not forget this. In the name of Jesus, I'm speaking to your thinking and your remembering. In Jesus' name, you're going to get up in the morning. You're not going to forget because if you put it into practice, you're not going to forget. Repetition is the best teacher. If you wake up in the morning and say, no, I'm going to worship. I'm going to touch heaven. I'm going to let faith begin to be developed, be strengthened, become powerful within my life. In the dimension of accessing heaven. By faith, I have access into that realm. by faith. I'm going to let faith become so strong and so developed and so powerful in my life by giving myself to accessing this realm of this manifest presence, this realm of glory. It's really not far away. It's right there. This man who went into heaven, he said he took one small step and he went over into heaven. He passed through a veil into the third heaven. That's how close it is. Hallelujah. The realm to see what's really Ishing, the revelation realm, insight realm, the behold, the earth is filled with his glory. Huh? Because there's another realm to see in. Ha, hallelujah. Ha, ha, ha. There's another eye. There's another realm to see. There's another perception of sight to use. Thank you, Jesus. Say repetition.
Repetition.
Okay. There's no way you're going to forget because you're going to get up in the morning and you're going to do this. You're going to give yourself, you're going to give your life to seeing faith become strong and developed. Right in the most important dimension of where it needs to be developed, because the rest of it's an overflow. All the rest of it, asking what you will, is an overflow of relationship. It's a rare overflow of intimacy. Your heart not convicting you or condemning you, and you asking whatever you will and Father do, overflow of relationship and intimacy. It's where faith needs to be developed and made strong. Out of that, you'll do great exploits. Out of that, you'll command the flame. As it were. How? By your consecration. You understand what I'm said?
Yes.
Because whether we live or whether we die, we're not going to listen to you, devil. Whether we live or whether we die, we're going to do what God said to do.
Amen.
Consecration. Consecration releases a realm of faith. Can you imagine how excited and how happy Father gets when he sees people who are walking in his love and have faith that works by love? Can you just imagine how happy and blessed Father gets when he sees people who are persecuted but they're blessed, who suffer wrongfully but they don't respond with offense? Do you know how praiseworthy that is, how thankful he is, how blessed he is that he has folks on the earth that will walk with him, that will agree with him? Man, we're just going to do this. Let me just say, I'm just going to do this.